If I found you not to attend cabinet 3 times without reason, you are out of government.
Idi Amin was a Ugandan military dictator who ruled the country from 1971 to 1979. During his reign, he was responsible for the deaths of tens of thousands of people, as well as widespread human rights abuses and political repression. Amin's rule was marked by a combination of brutality, erratic behavior, and megalomania, which made him a figure of fear and revulsion both inside Uganda and around the world. Amin was born in 1925 in Koboko, in the northwestern part of Uganda, which was then a British colony. He joined the British colonial army in 1946 and served in various units until Uganda gained its independence in 1962. Amin quickly rose through the ranks of the Ugandan military and was appointed commander of the army in 1970. The following year, he staged a coup and seized power from the democratically elected government of Milton Obote. Amin's regime was characterized by a number of policies and practices that were designed to consolidate his power and intimidate his opponents. One of his first actions as president was to abolish the constitution and suspend civil liberties, including freedom of the press and the right to assembly. He also declared himself president for life and began to cultivate a cult of personality around himself, with his image appearing on billboards and posters all over the country. One of the most notorious aspects of Amin's rule was his treatment of his political opponents and other perceived enemies. Amin's secret police, the State Research Bureau, was notorious for its brutality and torture, and political opponents were routinely arrested, tortured, and executed without trial. In addition to political opponents, Amin also targeted ethnic and religious minorities, particularly the Ekoli and Lango peoples in northern Uganda, who he saw as potential threats to his rule. Amin's rule was also marked by economic mismanagement and corruption. Despite Uganda's rich natural resources and fertile agricultural land, the country's economy stagnated under Amin's leadership as he diverted resources to fund his military and personal lifestyle. In addition, he frequently expelled foreign investors and seized their property, leading to a collapse in foreign investment and a decline in economic growth. One of the most infamous incidents of Amin's rule was the expulsion of Uganda's Asian population in 1972. Amin ordered all Asians, who were mostly of Indian or Pakistani origin, to leave the country within 90 days and seized their property and businesses. This action led to the forced displacement of over 80,000 people and the loss of much of Uganda's skilled workforce, leading to further economic decline.
Are you worried? Some people seem worried here about the situation actually in Uganda.
Well, definitely. You see that at moment, as you can see, every day you get a bloody new forms to fill it up. And every day new law, you know, and new rules. And you don't know what to do next. You go East African Airways, they give you a form to get a ticket, then you...
Why do you think the president is doing this?
Well, he might be a madman or something like that.
Everybody depends on luck, but they are mostly very... more than they require.
More than terrified?
More than terrified, no.
Are you?
Everybody, not myself. Everybody in this line also.
The expulsion was carried out in a brutal and chaotic manner, with little regard for the rights or well-being of the affected population. Indians were given only a few days' notice to sell their businesses and homes, and many were forced to leave behind their possessions and assets. Amin's regime seized the property and businesses of those who left, further enriching the regime and its supporters. The expulsion was carried out with the active involvement of the Ugandan military and security forces. Indian-owned businesses were raided and looted by government forces, and Indian families were forcibly removed from their homes and detained in internment camps. Many were subjected to harassment, violence, and intimidation, and some were killed or disappeared without a trace.
You know, from experience, we've discovered that Asians are very, very shrewd, and they've been exploiting this country for a very, very long time. So if the president gave them a very long time, they would have really succeeded in taking everything from this country.
Do you have no qualms at all about the decision to tell people to get out in 90 days?
Not at all. Why should I? I think President Amin is in the right direction.
But what about the queues of extremely worried and quite often frightened Asians saying, we don't know where we're going, we don't know what's going to happen to us, why can't we get out of the country, our papers are being held, that kind of thing. Doesn't that worry you at all?
But for people who have been living with Asians, we know how much they can panic, you know, when it's a minor thing. And that's why they're, you expected this. In fact, they are doing it better. We expected much more confusion than there is today.
Why?
Because they are known as the most panicky people in the world. If you've been living with these people, you would, you know, just know that this is the right thing they're doing.
The Indian government and international community responded with shock and condemnation to the expulsion. India, which had maintained close economic and cultural ties with Uganda, protested the move and offered assistance to the affected population. The United Nations and other international organizations also condemned the expulsion and called for the protection of the rights of the affected population. The expulsion of Indians had a profound impact on Uganda's economy and society. Many businesses and industries, including banking, textiles, and manufacturing, were severely affected by the loss of skilled labor and expertise. The Ugandan shilling, which had been pegged to the Indian rupee, suffered a sharp devaluation, leading to hyperinflation and economic instability. Another one of Amin's follies was the now infamous Operation Entebbe. In June 1976, a group of Palestinian and German terrorists, members of the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, PFLP, and the German Revolutionary Cells, hijacked Air France Flight 139 en route from Tel Aviv to Paris. The hijackers diverted the plane to Entebbe, Uganda, where they demanded the release of Palestinian prisoners held in Israeli jails in exchange for the release of the hostages. Idi Amin, who was known for his support of Palestinian militants, immediately offered his assistance to the hijackers. He ordered the Ugandan military to surround the airport and provided the hijackers with logistical and diplomatic support.
I came so close to the Arab because Arab found that I am most influential leader in Africa, in the continent, and also I am a leader who speaks the truth.
Did your Muslim religion take part into your choice of the Arabs?
It is not because of the Muslim, because the people who broke relationship with Israel, they are not only Muslims, they are Christians, but they have seen the truth.
As negotiations between the hijackers and the Israeli government stalled, Amin became increasingly belligerent towards the hostages and the Israeli government. He threatened to kill the hostages if his demands were not met and personally visited the hostages to intimidate them. In response, the Israeli government authorized a daring rescue mission known as Operation Entebbe. Israeli special forces, including members of the elite Sayeret Matkal unit, flew into Entebbe under cover of darkness and successfully rescued 102 of the 106 hostages. Although Amin was not directly involved in the rescue operation, he was widely criticized for his role in the hijacking and for providing support to the terrorists. The international community, including many African leaders, condemned Amin for his actions and accused him of supporting terrorism. The incident further damaged Amin's already tarnished reputation and contributed to his eventual downfall. Amin's erratic behavior and megalomania were also a hallmark of his rule. He frequently made grandiose claims about his military prowess and diplomatic accomplishments, and was known for his eccentric behavior and unpredictable mood swings. He was also notorious for his lavish lifestyle, including his love of expensive cars and luxury goods, which he acquired using state funds. In 1978, Amin launched an invasion of Tanzania, which he saw as a potential threat to his rule. The invasion quickly turned into a disaster as Tanzanian forces, with the help of Ugandan exiles, pushed back Amin's army and launched a counter-invasion of Uganda. Amin was eventually forced to flee the country in 1979 and went into exile in Saudi Arabia, where he remained until his death in 2003. In the years since Amin's rule, Uganda has undergone a process of democratization and economic reform. However, the legacy of Amin's brutal regime still haunts the country, and the scars of his rule continue to be felt by many Ugandans. Amin remains a controversial figure, with some viewing him as a national hero who stood up to Western imperialism and defended African interests, while others see him as a brutal dictator responsible for widespread human rights abuses and economic mismanagement.